Good morning to all of you. This is the 19th webinar of IGS Guntur chapter. Myself, secretary IGS Guntur chapter. Guntur chapter established in 2003, organized a number of seminars, workshops, significant being IGC 2009 national conference. I am thankful to Professor Ashish Juneja, IIT Mumbai, so for delivering this lecture, Geotechnical Surprises Along the Two Epic Railway Journeys in the Western Ghats. Before introducing him, few announcements to participants. I request all the participants stop video and the chat with the host only during the lecture, that is myself. And during the lecture, you can chat audio and video issues only. Please do not share your information and questions during the lecture and the question answer session at the end of the lecture. And after completion of the lecture, I'm going to share Google Form link, and its purpose is your feedback, and we will share video content only. Due to certain constraints, we are not sharing PDF content of the lecture. And question answer session at the end of the lecture. Our next webinar on 1st June, that is on Monday at 11 a.m. And the title of the webinar is Engineered Landfill Design and Construction. Speaker, Mrs. Dola Roy Chowdhury, Principal Consultant, G-Cube Consulting Engineers, Pune, Maharashtra. Now I feel it privilege in introducing Professor Ashish Juneja. He is a professor at IIT Bombay. He earned his doctorate from NUS Singapore 2002. He holds his master's degree from IIT Delhi in 1996 and bachelor's degree from University of Roorkee in 1993. Presently it is IIT Roorkee. Dr. Juneja worked intermittently in the industry for nearly 8 years in India and UK before returning to the academia in 2005. His research interests are in the dynamic soil behavior, numerical and physical modeling of underground structures, and ground improvement works. He has supervised one postdoctoral and 8 doctoral students, and is presently guiding 4 doctoral students for PhD. He has also supervised over 15 master dissertations at IIT Bombay. He has co-authored over 80 journal and conference publications and 2 book chapters. Professor Juneja has received research grant from DST, MOES, DRDO, Railways, and a number of other public and private organizations. He also serves as a consultant to various government agencies and national and international organizations such as Railways, NPCL, Mumbai Metro, Nagpur Metro, BMC, Samsung Engineering, John Deere, and John Deere. Dr. Juneja's teaching performance has consistently been evaluated as one of the best. He has been teaching core subjects in geotechnical engineering at undergraduate level and subjects on constitutive models and ground improvement at postgraduate level. Some of his popular courses have been transmitted live through ISRO's satellite to remote centers and other engineering colleges across India. In recognition of his outstanding contribution to teaching and research, he received Excellence in Teaching Award twice in 2012 and 16, IIT Bombay Industrial Impact Award 2014, and Best Paper Awards. So I'm thankful to Professor Juneja. Now I request him to proceed for the lecture.
Thank you, Professor Rao, and thank you for inviting me for this lecture. It's a privilege to actually address such an august and huge gathering. Okay, I'll just minimize a few things, please. So the title of my presentation is in fact leads to two train journeys which start from Mumbai, and one journey which goes towards the Pune, and the second journey which starts from Mumbai and goes towards Goa. So I'm going to address some of the issues many, in fact, many travelers would have observed on the way, and these issues, how railways have tried to resolve these issues over the years. So the first one, part of the section which starts from Bombay to Pune, it's actually a smaller section, which is Karjat to Lonavala, which I would discuss. In fact, this section is so important to Central Railways that they have a separate office which has been dealing with the and separate superintendent engineers who have been dealing with this section. In particular, I'll speak on a Monkey Hill station. It's called Monkey Hill because obviously a lot of monkeys are there, but now you'll find a lot of monkeys everywhere. The second one, in fact, the Monkey Hill station, I'll try to speak about two sites. The another site which I'll speak about is near Ratnagiri. It's again a very famous, infamous site, which was Nivsar station. And again, this site belonged to Konkan Railways, but nonetheless, it had a huge geotechnical challenge, and I'll try to focus on that as well. If time permits, of course, the Kalyan Kasara is again a smaller, it's just a few slides only, but it's important because you would have heard of a train being derailed, and I'll speak about that as well if time given. My presentation will focus on the background, some geotechnical and hydrogeological studies. Stability and strength, I would not focus too much because it requires a bit of equations, mathematics. So I want to make this presentation simple and interesting. But nonetheless, I'll do a flyover over this aspect. And brief. And lastly, we'll see how we learn from all the failures which we see. Now, because this presentation was from Monkey Hill, to again Ratnagiri. So in fact, my alternate title, which I thought would be more appealing to the people, would be from Lonavala Monkey Hill. That's two Alfonso mangoes of Ratnagiri, which are quite famous. So we'll see the geotechnical surprises along the Indian railway journeys. Okay, so I'll continue. I hope my audio is clear and my presentation is clear.
Yes, sir.
Move on. Thank you. So the Karjat Lonavala is interesting because it is only 28 kilometers, but within the 28 kilometers, you have 27 kilometers of tunnels. I'm sorry, 27 tunnels, both short and long tunnels. And it's Western Ghats, part of Western Ghats is the Sahyadri Ranges. It passes through Sahyadri Ranges. And these hills reach up to 600 meter high. So you can, if you can see the background, you see a railway track. We'll again have a lot of images on this, but it's huge. It's about 300 to 400 meters above, and you have another 200 to 300 meters above the railway track. So it's again somewhere, I would say, midway of the hill. It receives huge rainfall. In fact, the entire Konkan region receives few thousands of millimeter, and again over 3 to 4 meters of rainfall it receives in monsoon with a very short period, because of which a large quantity of material gets eroded and washed out, which leaves the rocks, exposes the rock with the joints, it exposes the joints, it brings out loose pockets of rock. And there's a perennial continuous threat of rock stability along this. Especially because if you're aware, during the summer season, the temperature variation and humidity is high. So you see a lot of, material getting eroded, and rockfall is again a common issue over here. So these rocks have tendency to detach, and you see a lot of rockfall hazard in this area. So we were fortunate to have some data. Central Railways has collected all the rockfall history from 2006 onwards and up to 17. So there's a short video over here. It's only, I think, about 20 seconds, but it gives, how the incidents have, 124 incidents have happened. Now this morning I tried to click play over it. It didn't play. It only gave audio. Let me try again. If it doesn't play, I'll independently play the video separately. But in this video, you'll see some circles coming up, popping up. The size of the circles shows the volume of the the rock fall. And if you see a star shape, it's more like a landslide happening, a huge landslide. There's some background music for this 20-second, which will actually is purposely kept for this. Let me see and click. No, so the video not there. Please allow me to minimize this, and I'll show you the small video. Here. Start again, please. Now observe, this is the Monkey Hill. I'm sure maybe you can see my mouse. That's the Monkey Hill. Karjat is somewhere on the left and Lonavala is somewhere on the right, I believe. I think yes. And we are speaking about this stretch. This stretch over here is a track which comes, and there's another set of track on the other side of the hill. Now, interestingly, all the incidents have happened on this side of the hill. Until now, there has been no major incident on the other side, which is hidden by the hill. So we'll just look at the other side in a while. But right now, the focus is on this side, wherein the data was collected. Now, I'll play the video, please. It's only 20 seconds long. Yep, sorry. You would have noticed two things. First one, the number of rockfall events in the last few years have increased. And bigger hazardous incidents have happened in the past few months. Since, in fact, if you look at the data from 2017, you'll see that, some newspaper cuttings, if you do a Google search on newspaper, you'll see Monkey Hill coming up a lot. In 2017, and 18, so 17 data, major incidents happened. In fact, these were the first time when, the boulders, huge boulders had hit the train. So in July 2017, a boulder had crashed into the engine of a Mumbai-Hyderabad Express, and it pushed the engine off the track. A month later, you would have read this news very well. A family was having dinner in the Hubli LTT Express train, and all of a sudden a huge boulder fell in the buggy and punctured through the train buggy, and fortunately no one was seriously hurt. Right, so these two incidents plus the incident which happened in 2018. In 2018 again, boulders had fallen down on the track. The figure on the photograph on the left-hand side, you'll see a smaller size boulders, but huge, boulder in the middle figure. And you'll see, probably see about 10 people who are trying to pull this off, and it's not easy. So if you look at the size, it's probably, it's weighs more than about 3 ton. We're looking at, if you're assuming that it's again a 1 meter cube plus. There's another short video, which is again, I thought it was live when taken, when small size, cobbles and, boulders were falling off the hill. And fortunately, somebody was there to record it. Again, I'll have to minimize this. I'm sorry, I do not know why it didn't work today. I'll minimize this, but this is how technology is. When you need something,
it doesn't... Excuse me, sir. Please. Please take a new share and click the bottom of the video two check boxes are there. New share you can take, sir.
Okay.
Please take new share, and in the bottom two check boxes are there to show video.
Yes.
Then you can click the two check boxes, sir. Then you can show your video, sir.
Okay. This video is again. Okay, I'll do that. You're confusing me now. This is the second share. Yeah, this is the video page. Again,
okay, sir. Now we are able to.
Let me pause. You'll see the small pieces actually falling down. Let me caution you. This is not a real incident. In fact, if you see, there are people up there. They were all fallen over the night, and continuously it was falling down, and they are actually assisting the clearing the entire debris. So, is this my second share, please, Dr. Ramarao, or my first share? I'll see if this works. Sorry, we are back. So, because of these serious incidents, the railways decided to, do something about it. This was in 2017, and where actual survey was started. During this survey, it was decided that a particular stretch, that's the Monkey Hill, which is the hill over here, this part is especially vulnerable. And it was decided to just do a pilot study of a 1 kilometer stretch. So 1 kilometer stretch is somewhere where my mouse or the highlighter is. That small stretch was taken as a study and, how best we can resolve this issue. So the two tracks, blue and white, as we said, one white which goes on this side of the hill, blue on the other side. Incidentally, the blue track is where the railways carry the goods train, and the white track is where the passengers train travel. White track is there because the view is, in fact, the view is excellent on both the sides, but you have more waterfall on this side. So people really, who go to Lonavala from this stretch, they really like the view.
Sir, excuse me, sir. PPT is not clear. Kindly close the two shares and start with fresh share, because you are using the video share, maybe.
Okay. Yeah. Just to ask you, is my share closed? Everything closed?
Everything you can close, sir. Start a fresh.
No, am I sharing anything right now?
No, sir. You are not sharing anything. No, sir. It is not. It is shady. So it is not similar to the first one. Beginning you have shown, sir. It is shady.
I wanted to close everything about this.
Still, it is not clear. It is shady only.
I'll try once again.
Okay, sir. Stop all the shares, sir.
Yes.
Video sharing, please do not click, sir.
I'll remove this. I think this will help.
Now it is fine, sir. Okay.
Yeah, I think the two check marks for video.
We have to remove, sir.
It destroys the PPT.
Yes. Now it is fine, sir.
So I could quickly run through this. Because the access to the site is an issue, the only way to access the site is through train. Getting a good geotechnical investigation done was an issue. So whatever the existing testing was available, done historically, and looking at literature, we had some properties. I would say, let me quote unquote, assumed a lot of properties when we had to look at the analysis. So looking at the survey, which was also done, this survey was done using a drone, and different sections were taken at every 10 meter interval. We, using this, we kind of identified five locations which were more critical along this pilot study. So these locations were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'll quickly run through those five locations, which incidentally are just photographs. The first one, for example, is 110 meter, and the gradient starts from 50 to 60 degree and goes up to 80 degree. What you see over here, the black lines are the railway tracks, and the crosses are the poles. These crosses were important because you had to have a good control point in order to correctly, identify the cross sections. So in fact, to give you a historical background, there were three drone surveys done, and each time the survey was incorrect, and only the last, when we really pointed out, when we could do a closed loop study that the error is minimized, we accepted that. And this whole thing was not easy. Reason is, you can only do drone during summer when the vegetation is low. Otherwise, the whole hill is covered by vegetation. So you had it took a year plus to get this thing done. And the railways were quite itchy. Everyone was itchy in this period. Large boulder size were found in this section one. I'll go to section two, that's location two, and bottom is location three. So bottom is location three. Location two incidentally had some ISMB section system. There were existing sections which were all damaged because of rock fall. I'll speak about this rigid retaining member in a while. But you could also see a lot of debris on the the channels, the flow path, the joints between two different rocks. So the crevices, there were a lot of debris. And much of the debris was precariously located, which were, in fact, a slightly heavy monsoon would have again triggered another rockfall incident. I think this is location three. And you should see again a rigid member. So these are concrete walls, rigid members, and a lot of damage happened to them. So incidentally, we could trace the path of the rock in these four such incidents. Location four, again, is where the family which was having dinner in the Hubli LTT Express. That is the location four. Incidentally, when I come towards the end of the site, I'll just speak about this location briefly, let you know the current status. Location five, a lot of unstable rock mass. You could see, you know, rock pieces wedged in the gully, and this was the longest length of over 310 meters. Yeah, so what were the options? The options are, what are the mitigation systems to be adopted? So the best one is to, which is more effective, but in this case, which also requires a minimum maintenance. So the groups into three categories, the mitigation systems in a textbook format, they are grouped into three categories. One is prevention, wherein you scale or trim the loose debris, whatever is prone to fall. You also kind of have a tendency to shotcrete the rock pieces and apply rock anchors. So these are the first one. Incidentally, this is more of an active support, because you actually have supports which are kind of, you know, when you say shotcrete, some kind of, you apply some tension or some kind of active. So already the rock anchors are stressed. So we call it active. The other one is retention, where you just lay a mesh or net and you support with nails or anchors. These anchors are not stressed. So it's actually, you allow the boulder or the rocks to fall down the net and collect the boulders somewhere at the bottom. The last is the protection measure, where you have ditches, sheds, and the barriers. You're going to speak about these barriers a lot in the next few minutes. Usually you have a combination of more than one or two methods, and more importantly, the selection depends upon how many incidents have happened, what is the energy of the rock debris which falls down. More importantly, like I said, the maintenance issue, because you're not able to maintain this off and on. Before I continue, I must pause and let you know that the railways have done an excellent job. I mean, if you say that in this period, all these years, we have had little, obviously incidents have happened, but these are the people who walk down the track. The lineman walks down the track, checks every inch of the track every morning before the first, before the light, train start. And there are about 100 trains running over these tracks in a day. So these are the people who really deserve our salute. Now, these are the, coming back to the, the mitigation measures. I would not like to, scare you by looking at this table, because if you are keen, you can go to IRC SR23. It has, this is summary from there. So probably you can zap it from this, but please look at the first column and the last column. The last column says, how the cost starts from low to very high. So you're looking at scaling trimming, which is the cheapest one and which is normally done in this part of the country. And if I go down, I have barriers, which are flexible barriers, and then rock shed. We'll mainly speak about a lot of things, but just to let you know, rock shed is like putting a concrete dome over the entire track. Obviously, you need, if the prone area is small, is a small area. Sorry, this whole thing is disturbing me. If the problematic area is small, then you could consider, but it's a very expensive one. You will find some literature on it, because recently ETH Zurich has done a lot of research work on this, how they have used a permanent rock shed, but it's again low maintenance. You would have, again, let me just skip this and go to next, because there's again a lot of literature. We'll look at those five locations which were identified, and I'll focus on these two, which is highlighted in yellow. One is the drapery system. I'll just cover this up very quickly, and the flexible rockfall barrier, which is a relatively new system to this country. There were other methods which were in the table, and I quickly rushed to the table, obviously because I wanted to cover this line. The systems such as earth embankment or concrete and gabion walls were not at all considered. First of all, earth embankment, gabion wall requires huge space, which is not available. If you look at concrete wall, it's a rigid member, again prone to a lot of damage. There were other preventive measures such as shotcreting with nailing. They had, in this site, there was a history of poor durability. In fact, I would like to let you know, see, whenever there's, this is the first one, you see a layer which is about few inches thick, which has in fact separated away from the back layer. The back layer is the rock, and this is the shotcrete which has separated out. And a lot of chunk has in fact washed away. This is a chunk. This would invariably happen when you have a lot of water pressure behind this. Remember, you have an impermeable barrier over here. The water has to escape. Whatever channels you provide, they would be ineffective in long term. And then you have this whole thing, it's actually washes out. Again, another chunk, this is again, it exposes the steel over there. So again, like I said, shotcrete is again was an issue which we removed right at the beginning. So the first one is draped or mesh system. Its design criteria, I'll rush through it because I don't want to show a lot of equations, but it's again based on limit equilibrium. Simple limit equilibrium where you have the forces coming up because of the weight of the mesh. So that's, these arrows small are the weight of the mesh. You assume a small thick layer which is about to slide, and you can also add on to the weight of the debris which has accumulated at the bottom. So you look at the stability of this mass, and you look at what are the ratio of stabilizing forces to, stabilizing forces to destabilizing forces. Because you use, you look at factors at an individual level, you look at factors for each and every case, every scenario. Again, these are the input parameters which were used. Some of them were taken from literature. Some of them were again from some experience published again, literature itself. There are two issues with it. Prediction can be difficult because you simplify a problem. It's a complex problem and you have simplified it greatly. So whatever you predict, it's not an easy. And of course, you're looking at a system which is able to retain about 1 meter size of a boulder. So again, a lot of uncertainty is involved even in this design. At the end, of course, these are the issues which were, as a result of analysis, you had again anchor bolts which were installed in a grid and a high steel wire mesh. At some locations, it was rhomboidal shaped wire mesh which was used because the rock over here was highly weathered. I'll quickly run through what the design is for rockfall barrier. These are the flexible barriers. Why I say I want to run through it, because it's mainly manufacturer specific. Not much literature is available. It's only what people who make it, they have specified the testing, and I'll just look at what these systems look at once they are installed. It's a flexible mesh, so you can see it's a mesh which is held onto by cables, and you have more importantly some energy dissipators at the top, and I think they should be at the bottom, yes. And you have a bracing system to hold on. So whatever rock falls from upslope hits the barrier. This is a flexible barrier. It's allowed to, elongate. And the elongation can be easily be few meters. In fact, in the design, we accept that the elongation of up to 3 or 4 meters is acceptable. So because it's allowed to elongate, it is allowed to also, you know, multiple hits. It can tolerate multiple hits as well. So when I say elongate, it means I don't want to, you know, too much of plastic deformation to occur. I would normally design this to at about one third or less, one third, half, maybe less of its ultimate energy capacity. So these barriers are sold in the market. Let me quote unquote sold in the market as what is the kilojoule of energy it can resist. And I'll just look at an example in the next few slides. But the part of this is what is shown in the first column. It's of this table. You have an interception structure, which is a net. That's the net over there. A smaller net and a bigger net. A support structures, which are these pipes. And the components, which are again the energy dissipators or the brake elements, which are pretty important, and they help to transmit the entire energy to the foundation. Yes. So like I said, they're manufacturer specific. They have mostly been developed in Europe. There's an ETAG specification, you know, ETAG 27, which has been widely accepted as a guidance. They're designed to carry service load. Well, like I said, only one third of the ultimate load. And you have barriers which are typically from 1,000, 2,000 kilojoules. You can easily, look at what is the energy of the rock falling from a greater height. I'll just come to that. The thing is, when the barrier is along, we don't want the, after elongation, the barrier, the net should be close to the railway. And the height of the barrier should be greater such that any rock falling from a certain, distance does not overshoot the barrier. It should be retained by the barrier. You have foundations which are typically, can be a plinth if you have good foundation rock. In this case, we micro piles were to be used. This is a very simple school level physics which is used. So if I have a rock at the top, the energy of the rock is mgh. So that energy which we spoke about, kilojoule, you can easily correlate that energy to this mgh. Obviously, you can discount some fact of energy loss due to friction as the rock falls down an uneven surface. And if you're very keen about what is the velocity with which it hits the barrier, so that's the flexible barrier over here, and you have a train which is a cartoonic sketch shown. If the block hits the barrier, if you're keen to know what is the velocity, obviously, this potential energy converts to kinetic energy. And if I say the part of the potential energy is taken by rotation of the block, that means I would add omega to it. Again, school level physics, where kinetic energy is half mv square, and if there is one rotation component. Usually for larger blocks, this rotation component is ignored. I is, of course, the moment of inertia. So what we did was we chose a simple computer program. It's a commercial program, very easy to handle. So it was more chosen to know statistically where the barrier should be placed, because energy-wise, we are very confident what would be the energy of the falling rock. But the statistic location of the this program was helpful to determine where we should position the flexible barrier. So here's a flow chart which shows of the program. I'll just skip this. These are the screenshots of the program. It's in fact a rock fall. It's an easy to use, like I said. But of course, there are many others. You can try that. These are. That's one typical section where we don't have a barrier and we have projectiles falling down of the rock. And if you place a barrier, so this barrier is placed at the best location, which could minimize. You could see again, there are still two locations which are, but statistically speaking, we can ignore those two. this barrier was recommended for example, at location. I think this is location one. You have a 5 meter high barrier, which is of 2000 kilojoule at location one. Some of you, if you people are interested, you can take a screenshot of this. It's again references for a flexible barrier. I would highly recommend this IRC to SR23, and of course the paper by Pialo and Ronco. These have been they have stated how you design this. So if you are interested, you can just jot down this or take a screenshot. The advantage, the plus point which came out of this is, if you look at this, I would say, of course, like all government departments, railways, it takes time. But towards the end of the last year, we saw that a lot of newspaper coming up that this year, that means 2020, Central Railway will ensure that no disruption will happen in this monsoon. And from February this year, this was again, this year, February, it was expected that the work would have started. This was happened because, a tender document was floated based on this work, where for the first time, dynamic rock fall barriers were, part of the requirement. The unfortunate part is, the budget. The entire budget for the recommended budget for this project was about close to 37 crore rupees. But if you look at the numbers over here, it's about just 6 crore rupees, which was estimated. So what we will notice is it's only a small section. I think it's somewhere here. Kilometer 121, I think that's, no, sorry, it's here. It's hidden by this black line. But this is the same section where this LTT accident happened, where the family was having dinner. So at least it's a good start, and hopefully things will move on. But unfortunately, because of this COVID and lockdown, things have really stopped. Before I continue, can I just know how much time I have? Because in the last 30 minutes, I barely managed to finish one project. The next two projects are just 3 or 4 slides. If I can just manage to finish them, and the last one will take some time. So please, can Professor Rama Rao, how much time would you give me, please?
Please continue, sir.
How much time will you give me?
At what time you are planning, sir, finishing?
It depends on the patience of the audience, because the people, I don't want people to run away. So probably I'll try to finish another 15-20 minutes.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Thank you. This is a second site, which is, like I said, it's on the other side of the hill. Same Monkey Hill, but this time it's on the other side. This happened towards the end of last year. What is interesting is, if you look at the left-hand side photograph, the railway tracks have actually bent. There's a stretch of about 30 meter from, that's a railway engine just standing there. This engine was brought to bring us to the site. So there's a group of people, and it's just standing there because this whole track is the work is stopped. Over here, what you see, the track has bent. It's a 30 meter stretch. And beyond this abutment, so this wall, concrete wall, I'm sorry, it's a brick lined wall, boulder wall, apologize, is all a bridge. So this photograph has been taken over a bridge. And actually, the person who's standing, that's yours truly, is standing in a very precarious, because this gap, a thin person could have easily slipped through this gap. Fortunately, I'm not thin. So what you see over here on the right hand side, I'm just the stretch on the right hand side is on the photograph on the over here on your right. If you can see those small poles over there, these are all ISMB sections. They were installed when the first time when this whole mass started to move. So what has happened is, if I move on the left-hand side figure back again, this whole soil has started to move down. And if I go on the right-hand side figure, that's the whole mass which has started to slide. In fact, it has slid by more than 3 meters. It's a huge distance. If you look at the poles, which were these ISFB sections, which were way on the top, and they have moved by 3 meters down there. So you could imagine how dangerous this thing was. Every time the railway had to pass, they had to put ballast, throw ballast under it, put the stretch back, and then until, you know, the train passed away. And this is again a goods train. This stretch was used for goods train. So many passengers would not have known about this incident. In fact, this did not come onto in papers. The railway did a quick band-aid, patch-up work. So these are the ISMV sections. You will see some, over here, again, a flexible retaining structure being constructed at this end. And if I go to next slide, please. That's again a hand-drawn sketch, but you will find again, I'll just briefly take you up. This is the soil mass which is moving. That's the abutment which we showed, and these are the piers on which the railway track was there. And the photograph was taken from somewhere here. And the driver engine is somewhere here, which is again at a tunnel number 42. So it's as the tunnel comes out, there's a tunnel 40 over here on the left, right? So this whole mass was moving and the railways, as a patch-up, decided to put a gabion wall somewhere here, and they also wanted to put gabion at the bottom. So a cross section would be, that's a gabion wall somewhere here, and putting some support over here. Obviously, this whole thing was not working, because it was, in fact, the top gabion was adding more load to it, which was bad. And the bottom one obviously was, that's over here. The whole thing was prone to slid, because if you look at this whole section, a quick calculation will tell you that this is again, not a stable slope. I should have mentioned the slope is at 1:1. It's a rock-filled slope. I'll just show you a photograph on the next. Why this was happening? Let's look at this situation on the other side. There's a hill on this side. If I just go back to this, so you'll find the hill on the left-hand side, railway track, and then going down. The rainfall from this hill was collected in a chamber. So it's a hidden, it's a collected in a chamber, and then it's diverted at 90 degree. And this, after diversion, it goes down this bridge. I'll repeat, there's a 90 degree bend, over here. So the whatever is the water pressure which hits the embankment down there, there's a 90 degree bend. And then thereafter, it's allowed to fall out. The bending part is one which was of concern, because over the years, if I go next, over the years, it was thought that the embankment had deteriorated, and the constant seepage below the embankment had eroded the pines from within it. This was obviously an assumption, because this whole thing, if historically we looked at the, we were fortunate to get some original 1980s drawings, the as-built drawings and signatures. So that's about, close to 30 years plus, right? So, and what we saw was, this was again dumped rock in the drawings, dumped rock pieces, debris, which obviously came from this tunnel. Whatever, during the excavation of this tunnel, it was dumped over here. So it's loose. And if I show you the photographs over there, there's a lot of vegetation growth. So despite being loose, you have a lot of washout which has come out. And obviously washout is laterites. We are speaking about basalt, and we see a lot of laterites in this area. Again, this is the pier of the thing. And we were standing somewhere there. You could see that's the top, and that's down the slope. And this is another view as you look downward. So these are the people who were at the moment constructing those, the gabion walls. Obviously, the work was not good. Let me go back. So it was decided that, this it's best to, let me just go back. Yeah, it was decided that it's best to, not to salvage this, because after the Gabion Wall, the plan was to do some grouting. And let me tell you, I have another site. If I have time, I'll just discuss that, which shows that grouting in laterites has an issue. You have to be very careful when you do that. So the final recommendation was the easy way out and the quickest way out was, without much of an experiment, was this whole bridge deck, you construct two more decks. So this is not to scale. In fact, from here to there, I can construct, I can have two more decks. And from here to there is another bridge. It's not visible, but this is another bridge over here. So this small chunk of earth I can bypass by having by constructing a pier and deck. So this was in October 2019, and in January 2020, we are told that this has been constructed and is ready. Okay, it was ready in this year itself. So it didn't take long. The railways had to stop this this track for about 2 months plus. All the while, the goods train limited goods train were allowed. And just to let you know, railways, when you stop goods train, railways lose about 30 to 50 lakh rupees per day. You know, that's the amount of money earning just for because of the amount of goods to travel. One advantage over here, you remember, that's the on the left hand side photograph, that's the engine I showed. So you have to take if family comes with you, it's nice. So that's photograph of my daughter. She is, there's a certain age where children actually accompany you to site. So and beyond that age, they stop coming with you. So my son has passed this stage, so my daughter, fortunately, she still accompanied me in the. So that's that was it. This was another smaller, it's again too slight, but it's Kalyan Kasra section at near about 70 kilometers from Mumbai, near Asangaon station. Now this track is famous, or I must say infamous, because in August 2017, the Nagpur-Mumbai Duronto Express got derailed over it. Now it shows a curved one, but it's actually a straight stretch. It's just a photograph, the fisheye photograph, which has been taken. It's a long photograph. That's my PhD scholar, Shantan. Right now he's under lockdown. Now, sorry for him. What happened? I'll tell you. So what happened was the driver noticed a lot of debris flowing down this stretch during a heavy monsoon. Remember, heavy monsoon, it's all cloudy, visibility is poor, and a lot of debris flowing down. He obviously made a decision to suddenly apply brakes. You know, the whole train coming at some speed, if you apply brakes, obviously, the fault finding commission did not find any fault with the driver, because there was some, it was not very well known what would have happened had the train passed this debris. This debris was a huge of over 100, 200 to 300 millimeter size cobbles and stones. But because of that immediate braking thing, the whole train actually fell down. There was nine coaches which fell down. A lot of things happened. And incidentally, when the train falls down, such a thing happens. It takes a year to actually salvage this whole section, whole material. Railways don't take the train back. They just sell the whole thing as scrap. Fortunately, again, no deaths had happened on that particular day. So the debris which was noticed, now these are the photographs on left and right, are the the slopes which was there. And you see a lot of rock protrusion coming out, cobbles and somewhere boulders as well. So much of it is dislocated. You'd see it's naked. So actually one monsoon, again, it'll come out again. These will get dislodged over every two or three monsoons. This will probably get dislodged. So again, on that, for that particular day, let me speak about that particular day. it was estimated that the energy of these boulders and cobbles, would be only of order of few thousand joules. If you look at it, MGH, again, simple physics will tell you, these thousand joules would not have been too strong to in fact derail this the train, but it would have actually caused some kind of because had they blocked the track up, they would have caused severe, at least not derailing, but damage to some extent, that there was something would have happened. So obviously it was agreed that the driver did the right thing. But one important thing was, in this entire survey, there was no evidence of landslide or any deep-seated slope failure. Okay. Even a quick, again, limit equilibrium analysis of this whole slope. And this slope is again midway. If I even take a slope up to a next extent where the railways had to, for future expansion, it was still considered safe. Now the problem is, again, when a lot of water flows down, where does it go? So obviously this photograph, all these photographs have been taken with the hill on my back end side. So the hill is on my back, I face the railway track. So all the water which comes down the hill has to flow under the track. If you look at these, there are, if I remember, these are only two drains, or maybe three drains. All these drains belong to the British era. Look at the size. These are all old historical trains where, the Britishers had built only one track. Over the years, we have built another track over there, and we have only safely extended this bridge to the other end. So I think this photograph over here is the other end. What you see is the size of the drain, and it's all choked with human waste. Obviously, we have to be careful, but thing is, this whole thing will not allow water to easily pass through below the track. There was certain set of recommendations based on this. Firstly, the factor of safety was greater than unity, as I just said, both for short-term and long-term stability. All loose cobbles of up to 300 mm size were to be removed. And visibly, unsupported pieces were also to be removed, because they would have obviously fallen down after the next monsoon. In fact, after this slope, debris which had moved huge amount, the same hill has seen one more monsoon. So nothing has happened on that monsoon. That's last year. This year we have yet to see. The area near the openings and drain were cleared. There's also proposal to build three new large diameter drains. This was important, because otherwise there would have been huge collection of pool of water at one end. There was proposal to build gabion wall. Let me just go next, show you next photograph. This gabion wall was there again to arrest the debris flow. And during that year, it was noticed that a small section of gabion wall, was good enough to even arrest part of the debris. So it was proven to be useful for this site as well. Now, I'm not going to continue to this, because this is a large site, but I'll just, in 1 or 2 minutes, I'll tell you what the problem was over here. This site, I think a lot of people would be aware of it, because many institutes have been involved. My colleagues have been involved in this, and it has a big history. It's NIFSA station. If you do a Google search on NIFSA station, you'll notice that from Ratnagiri to Goa, it's just about 23 kilometers ahead. As the train used to pass through this section, after 2005, the trains used to literally crawl. In the sense, from this part to this part, people could jump out of the train and walk along with the train. It was that was the crawling speed. Reason was, this entire mass of soil, embankment, was under collapse during monsoon each year. So the shape of this from the top is over here. That's the photograph over here. That's the amount of decay of the under the track which has happened. Those are the railway tracks. And the entire mass has moved towards the left hand side of your, you know, the of your screen. And left hand side is down this slope over here towards the river. Okay. Now from 2005, that was the major when, you know, rainfall had happened. A lot of ground improvement works had been done. If I remember correctly, I think I'm not going to go through these ground improvement works individually, but this is interesting. This is amount of cement bags used in that improvement works. Okay. And in 2000, from 2006 onwards, this was done. But every year, they could see that, you know, the ground moved. It was only, I think, in 2007 or so, it didn't move. But every year, it moved and it kind of mimicked or replicated the same failure shape every year. So what the railways had to do was, again, put in a lot of stone ballast every year below the tracks, lift the track, and then allow the train to pass through. And you would, I mean, it's quite hard to imagine that each year, the ballast used to move, and the amount of, you know, ground movement was above 2.5 meters. So within 3 or 4 years, the total, you know, fill, rock fill below the track was about 9 meters. This was very scary because if you look at an design of this, you know, the railway track, the ballast, stone ballast is not more than, I think, half a meter in the design. And we are looking at 9 meters in this case. This, because of this scary thing, the village down the slope, all the village houses were destroyed. The railways had compensated them by giving them alternate land. But you would know that human tendency is when alternate land is given, that is also mine, and the existing land is also mine. So the villagers never allowed the railways to properly investigate this area. Nonetheless, this area was investigated. And so that's the old, you know, whatever the ground improvement works were done. I don't have time to go through it. I'll just skip this. But yes, interesting part was, post-investigation, it was noticed that this was the platform level, that's the track level. The whole failure surface, in fact, had the shape of a typical idealized, you know, rotational failure, which is observed, you know, in a slow failure, where you have the scrap, you have the transverse cracks, you have the slump. The same thing was observed when we mapped the entire hill. Transverse cracks over here. So in fact, it was a typical, I would say, a slow failure, which was, you know, missed out in the earlier investigations. Settlement record, rainfall. I would very much would have loved to discuss all this, but I'm sorry, I'll skip all this because I have taken more than my time. I'll skip all these slides and go back just to the conclusion, please. I'm sorry, I have taken more time. One thing which I think I should tell you is about, when we speak about laterites. So we did, this is something which all of you would have done, you know, done UU test or UCS test. So that's vertical is undrained shear strength and horizontal is degree of saturation at the same dry density. So these are typical UU test results. I mean, correctly speaking, this should not be called as undrained shear strength because the degree of saturation of all these samples from one and less is less than 100%. So it's not undrained, correctly undrained, because now you're allowing the water to, flow within the sample. So once you allow water to even flow within the sample, you know, it's not undrained. Nonetheless, you see the strength reduction. So that's the idea which you're looking at. From a fully saturated sample, I'm sorry, here, fully saturated sample, which is about 100 UCS of 100 kPa, to a dry sample, which is 300 plus. So you're looking at, in fact, 1/3 strength reduction with the increase in water content. This is, again, typical of laterites, which are as hard as stone during summer season. And during monsoon, they become slush. So this is a very important, I would say, an important research area, which in fact I would advise many students who are listening to, you know, if they could, you know, bring out or come out with good ideas. We also did centrifuge test over here. We have a centrifuge. I won't discuss this, I'm sorry. And I'll straight away come to conclusion. My conclusion is, although maintenance can be minimized with all these methods, but it cannot altogether eliminate it. You need to be careful. It has to be monitored. And the second is, which is again there, is which is not there in RDSO standard, and we would very much like to see this one day, that in the embankment design, the effect of live train load should be considered in the embankment design. I would like to acknowledge, a few people who were very helpful. So, you know, almost the entire staff of Central Railway is excellent. In particular, there was Mr. Yadav, who actually, you know, is equal to, I think, superintendent engineer. He was hands-on person on the site. I mean, I rarely have seen such a person. Despite having so much of stress, he was, you know, too good at the site and his entire staff. There was again for Konkan project, which NIFSA project, I think Rajendra Kumar is again chief engineer at that time. Now he's the director at Konkan Railways. He's a fine person. In fact, because of this NIFSA project, Railways have given him an award. He's got an award for that, for this project. Fortunately, I have also got an award for this NIFSA project. And I'd like to thank my colleagues here in IIT Bombay and all the research scholars, students who have actually helped me. Preparing this PPT last 2 nights, 2 days have been a very daunting task for me and my family. Although I had agreed to do it, but I didn't realize that I didn't have all the material, you know, all was very sketchy and here and there. Before ending, I'd like to show you 1 minute video. It's a wonderful video. People who travel along this region, would love to see this. And it's the first time, I think you people are the first time you're looking at it, because it's taken through using drone. And this drone was, and no one has seen it. So I would say you're the first few people who would look at this. Let me minimize this, please, and show you the video independently. Professor Rama Rao, I'm not going to, share another video, thing, because it's just a small 1 minute video. The background music is done by Surveyor, so you'll have to excuse me. I don't know where did he go. I'll start again. Sorry, the audio may be too high for some people. I'll reduce it. This is good. It's a 1 minute video, but it's taken through drone, along the Monkey Hill. This whole thing is the Monkey Hill. And this is the track which was the first site, the 2 tracks where people traveled. That's the tunnel portal. Another portal, the stretch over there, that's another portal over there. And you'll find that the 2 tracks running on this end, so there's another tunnel, and you'll see somewhere over there is another track which goes on the other side of the hill. And your Monkey Hill station is over there. It's a beautiful picture. I'll tell you, it's the more you see it. Thank you. Let me close this. Unfortunately, I will not be able to share this video independently. As Professor Rama Rao said, he obviously arm twisted me that he can share this presentation, but because some of the data over here, I have to really seek permission, and my student and I, we are in the process of some paper writing. The the NIFSR data, which was the NIFSR Ratnagiri station, that has there is a paper published on it. So it has been published by co-authored by Rajendra Kumar, my MTech student. She was here, and myself. You'll find it if you Google search it. You'll find that paper, or just write to me. I'll share with that. The first one is in the draft stage. We'll just let you know once this is ready. Thank you very much. Professor Rama Rao, I'll now stop sharing my screen.
Yes, sir. Now I am sharing Google Form link. I request you all of you copy this. So its purpose is to send your feedback, and I will share video content of this lecture, video of this lecture. So all of you copy this Google Form link. So now you can send your questions through chat. So professor Juneja sir, you can observe the chat, and if you require, you can make it as a pop out.
Okay, I see the questions. It's popped okay, out. There are not many questions, so I do not know that actually is of concern to me. Maybe people didn't understand, or maybe you know. But yeah, there's one question I am just trying to read. I hope this was. It says it's from Yaguni Srinivas. It says it's observed that gamma value of 27 kilonewton meter cube is for rock. What kind of rock is this? Much harder than concrete? Yes, because if you look at it, basalt, normally weathered basalt, would have a density of about 2.3. And it goes up to 2.8, 2.7, 2.8. So 27 kilonewton per meter cube, I would say is on the higher side. I accept, but again, this probably was used because of, you know, you want to use a slightly pessimist parameter because of unknown variables. Okay, there is one question by Professor S.K. Sharma from Indore. He says, what were the parameters considered for design of rock bolt system in the Monkey Hill case? Like I said, rock bolt, you need to look at the full, I think two things you have to be careful of. One is this, the ultimate strength of the rock bolt and the pullout capacity. So the addition between the bolt and the, these are not pre-stressed bolt. Let me caution you, these are not pre-stressed. So, you know, you're just looking at the friction between the rock and the bolt. And I think somewhere if the data was shown, it was, I think this friction coefficient was about 0.3. So tangent delta was about 0.3, if I remember. Kiran Kumar has said, why RCC retaining wall with deep holes has not been proposed near railway embankment instead of gabion? The experience with RCC wall is is because of the rigidity of the wall. You do one impact if there is one impact of the rock fall, multiple impact of the rock fall, these rigid members are not able to take. If you look at this again in dynamic studies, people normally would prefer use a flexible a structure rather than a rigid structure, because it helps to absorb some of the energy. So RCC retaining wall, number one, you would need a very heavy retaining wall for this. If I have to consider the energy and properly design, that would require a much a bigger footprint. But if I use as a cantilever retaining wall, which was there, used at this site, it didn't work. Someone has asked, Satyansh Singh has asked me, what minimum diameter of rocks can be stopped by meshing? Okay, so there are two mesh which are there, if I'm not wrong. One is of a grid size of about 200 to 300 millimeters, and another one is slightly, I think it's about 200 millimeters of, or I don't think I have seen anyone go 100 unless you're actually looking at, because 100 millimeter size, you would normally expect them to not to cause so much of severe damage. So I think it's 200 to 300 millimeters. Pankaj Kumar Yadav has asked for cement grout, which is used for rock bolts, I think. So rock bolt, if I remember, being at the site, they use some kind of tubes. It's a grouted tube which is used, pre-mixed grouted tube, which is ready-mixed for rock bolts. I'm sorry, I'm not able to recall immediately what was the composition, but it's like sausage tube, you know. You have seen sausages? These are very similar to that. And they insert the tubes within the rock, within the hole, and then push the bolt into it. I think Purandar Adike has asked the same question. Oh, okay. So Meena has asked, why can't we use geosynthetic in this type of cases? Geosynthetic, I would imagine you would need a greater strength. I do not know if they have, what kind of ultimate strength they have, but again, geosynthetic products are, they have a very narrow range of range of this elongation compared to these flexible things, and energy absorption in this is more. I would have to look into a geosynthetic product, but I have never come across a case where they have used geosynthetic product for especially geogrid kind of thing. Thank you, I'll look into this. Engineer Srivastava has asked that precast box provision could have been possible with soil nailing. Yes, at one location they did this, they have done it. So I could not get a chance to discuss this, but this is, this section where they have used precast box with soil nailing is, if you go from Mumbai to Pune along the highway, drive along the highway, you come across, before you enter the enter the Ghat area, you'll see on the right hand side, if you're careful enough, there's a railway track going, and they have used precast box over there with soil nailing. Dr. Chitra has asked, have you taken the dynamic loading of the movement of the train into your study? We did not actually take this dynamic directly, but we added on to, like you said, a pseudo-static kind of study. But yes, dynamic loading would have been interesting, but given the time constraint, we only did a simple, added on a factor to the static loading and enhanced this one. I think additional factor has been done in a lot of literature before, so we were not, in fact, anywhere too much wrong in doing that. Okay, so Engineer Rahul has asked, what is the maximum height of the wall barrier as shown while explaining kinetic energy and potential energy of rocks? So these barriers, they come in different height, from 4 to 6, 7 meters. So having a larger height of up to 7 meters is not very strange. But you can have, for our case, I think a maximum height was about 5 meters. I think I have covered all the questions.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Any further questions, kindly send mail to Professor Ashish Juneja. Thank you, sir. Thank you to all the participants. Thank you, one and all.